Hello, everyone. Hello. Okay. Tonight, I have the honor of introducing Michael Reagan, who I originally heard speak when I attended my first conference as a high school student 5 years ago. Michael is the son of Ronald Reagan and Academy Award-winning actress Jane Wyman. Michael is the founder and chairman of the Reagan Group and also hosted a live radio show for over 26 years. In addition to his role as president of the Reagan Legacy Foundation, he serves on the board of the John Douglas French Alzheimer's Foundation. In 2005, he established the Michael Reagan Center for Advocacy and Research in partnership with the Arrow Child and Family Ministries. The center advocates for public policies that will benefit the safety and stability of children and families, particularly those served by the welfare system. This is just a small list of the numerous charities that Michael Reagan has established and supported over the years. Also, Michael Reagan was honored by the Atlas Economic Research Foundation as the first Templeton Leadership Fellow for 2009 and 2010. In the book, Lessons My Father Taught Me, Michael looks back on his over his years with his father and reflects back on what he has learned from the greatest man he has ever known and one of the greatest men that the world has ever known. Please help me in welcoming Michael Reagan.
Yeah, it's great to be here. Who is it that is going to Santa Barbara College here? You? And I heard you say you came here to learn how to, you know, more how to be conservative and how to really stand behind your values. You're going to need them. As pretty as this place is up here, yeah. It's a bit liberal on its edges. So you're going to need to I'll put you on the prayer list for that one. So somebody asked me earlier tonight, said, where in the heck did you get that tie? I was giving a speech a few years ago in Georgia, and there was this black pastor who gave the invocation who was sitting next to me with his lovely bride, and he was wearing this tie. And this is what happens when your name's Mike Reagan. And I said to him, you know, during the end, I said, that's really a cool tie. He says, you like it? I said, yeah, I like it. It's a nice tie. And so the night ended, everything was over, everybody said goodnight, and I turn around, he's taking the tie off, he says, here, it's yours. And so I promised him I'd wear it on Fox sometime, and he said, that's great. And I think I wore it one time on Fox, and that was it. But I wore it tonight. But it's great to be here and always be with the young people here at the YAF conference here at the Young Americas Foundation and the Ranch Center here in Santa Barbara, and just kind of reminisce. And I know all of you are going to be going up to the ranch here in a couple of days and be able to see basically what I saw all my life. Even though this wasn't the ranch that I grew up on, your parents would know it as the Western White House, if you will. This is my dad spent a lot of time up here when he was not in Washington, D.C. He was, of course, at the ranch where he garnered all of his strength to be able to go back to Washington, D.C. and handle the liberals back in Washington and basically changed the world the 8 years that he was the president of the United States. I was the young man who got to go up to the ranch, but the one we had in Malibu Lake, California, in Northridge, California. I write about that in the book because so many people know my father is president of the United States or governor of California. How do you know your parents? You know him as mom. You know him as dad. That's how I knew my dad. It was interesting, though. Maureen, after my father was elected, my sister Maureen asked him, what should I now call you? And my dad said, well, you call me Dad. And Maureen went, okay, Mr. President. And that's kind of the way it was. But I knew my dad as Dad. That's how I knew him. And that's how I really got to know the things that I know. You're up here to learn about conservatism and what to do. But I learned it really just being with him on a regular basis, every single day, every Saturday. I came from a broken home, but my father never forgot about that first family, my sister Maureen and myself. And those Saturday mornings, that he would pick me up or pick my sister Maureen and I up in the station wagon and drive us out to the ranch. It was about a 45-minute drive out to the ranch in Malibu. And that's where I learned about America. I learned about every military organization known to mankind because he would regale us with nothing but the songs, the Air Force song, the Army song, the Marine song. He would just sing them to us. You know, Ronald Reagan just didn't become conservative and become a great American, you know, when he became governor of California. He lived it every single day of his life. And he instilled it in myself and my sister Maureen. We're still working on Patty and Ron. You can't be perfect. But the reality is that's how we learned it. We heard those stories that he would tell us about America and the great people of America, the great country that we grew up in. And it was those stories that really, really built me to who I am today. I didn't understand them that much when I was a kid. But as I got older, I really start to understand them. And the great thing about him was he never changed. As I got older, the stories got longer. As I got older and older, the stories got not only longer, but he would fill in more pieces. And you would learn more and more and more every day about America. I think one of the problems today in America, we don't love it the way he loved it. We haven't learned to love it the way Ronald Reagan learned to love it. My sister Marie and I, when my father was running for president, somebody asked us, is your dad really always like that? And Maureen explained it to him, said, you know, at home, we think of him as a Boy Scout, and what he's really after is the Eagle Badge, and the Eagle Badge is winning the presidency of the United States of America. And that truly was. Because even when he became president or when he was governor, he never changed. He was the same person yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And learned about faith from him, and I'll talk about that a little bit. I learned also the relationships he was able to build. He was able to accomplish so much, whether he was governor of California or president of the United States, because he knew how to build relationships. And he would even build relationships with people that he didn't agree with. But he knew he had to build relationships with these people to move anything he wanted to do, he wanted to move forward. Whether it was here in California, when he took over a state that was spending $1 million a day more than what it was bringing in. How do you turn that around? He was the only governor, by the way, to raise taxes in this state. And before he left office 8 years later, somebody came to him in his staff and said, Mr. or Governor, we have an issue. My dad said, what's the issue? He said, we have a surplus. What do we do with it? My dad said, well, you give it back. And they said, we don't have a way to give it back to the people of the state of California. So they had to devise a plan to give money back to the Californians who he felt had overpaid their taxes, and that's why they had a surplus. Can you imagine today, whether it's in your state or at the national level, a surplus and somebody in Congress saying, we have to find a way to get this money back to the people of the United States of America? It would never happen today. But it happened when my dad was governor of the state of California. Other than building relationships, he really had to know his audience. And how do you get to know your audience? Well, you have to go out and meet them. My father shook every hand when he would come into a room and shook every hand on the way out of the room before he would leave. So there's a lot of politicians today who come in to speak. And they're looking at the back door and looking at their watches when they can leave. You do not build relationships that way. People your age and a little bit older, who do they vote for? They vote for people they like and they can relate to. So there are people out there who may not have agreed with my father politically, but they voted for him because they could relate to him and he was likable. I tell the story in my book about one of the famous actors, Alec Baldwin. You might have heard the name. Alec Baldwin's become a staple of talk radio over the years because it seems every time he would speak talk radio, all you had to do was open up the airwaves and say Alec Baldwin, and the phones would ring for 3 hours about something he might have said. But Alec Baldwin, liberal, good actor. Didn't like Ronald Reagan. Didn't like any conservative. But a few years ago, I was working out at the gym with him, and I walked out, tapped him on the shoulder. I said, Mr. Baldwin, I said, my name is Michael Reagan, and Jane Wyman's my mother. And he looked at me, and I said, well, I told you Jane Wyman was my mother because I wanted to stay standing. Felt if I told you Ronald Reagan was my father, I might have had to duck. And he kind of chuckled at me. He said, you know, I'm so glad, Michael, you stopped me. I said, why? He said, because I was having dinner with some friends the other night, and I was telling him how much I missed your father. I said, you missed my father. You voted against him when he was governor. You voted against him when he ran for president of the United States. You disagree with everything he ever stood for. What do you mean you missed him? He said, what I miss about your father is his soul. And what the world today needs is the soul of Ronald Reagan back so that we can move forward again. And that was from a well-known liberal who voted against my father. And I think that's what all of us today are kind of looking for. We're looking for that soul, that person that we can really get behind and may not agree with all the time, but in fact, someone we can get behind and really be with and help them move the country forward. But you can only do that if you really truly love the country and know why you love the country. Ronald Reagan knew what he believed and he knew why he believed it. And that's one of the things you all have to learn also. And you'll learn a lot this weekend. You'll hear some great speakers. But you've got to know why you believe something. See, I didn't know what I believed for a long time. I campaigned for my father back in the 1960s when he ran for governor. I didn't know conservative from liberal. I didn't know Republican from Democrat. All I know is Dad was running for governor, and I thought that was cool. Why not? To be the son of a governor in the state of California, I thought it was going to be really kind of cool. I didn't know. My dad ran for governor. He won 2 times. I ended up getting into talk radio in the early 80s after he became president of the United States. And somebody called me on the phone one day, and they said, okay, we know what your father believes because I had spent so much time campaigning for my father, not only in the state of California for governor, but all over the United States of America when he was running for president. I knew how he felt about every issue known to mankind. My sister Marie and I could do a Q&A for an hour and a half, 2 hours, and just answer questions based on what my father felt. We knew him backwards and forwards. But somebody on the radio show one day called the show and said to me, okay, we know what your father believes. What do you believe? And at that point in time, in this early 1980s, I had no idea. I did not know what I believed. I knew what my father believed, but I didn't know what I believed because I hadn't gotten there yet to take the time to look at myself and say, okay, why do you believe these things? So I had to get there like you're going to have to get there in your own way. I had to learn why I was this way or I was that way, why I was conservative, what my beliefs were, who my friends were, and what have you. And we ultimately find out from my father and myself that my dad and I, pretty well on target. I got there my way, he got there his way, but at the end game, we were both conservatives. And that was just a great feeling once I figured it all out myself. But I had to listen to a lot of people. I had to do a lot of reading. And I had to be trustworthy of myself and not afraid to state my values, to state my case, to talk about the things I believed in. And even today, hasn't changed. I'll tweet something else. Yes, I do tweet, folks. Even though I look old, and I do tweet. I'm actually an old Republican who tweets and Facebooks. Okay, I have a 33-year-old daughter that takes care of my Facebook, but I'm the tweeter. Excuse me. So, you know, and you see the reactions you get in social media. You all know that when you send out tweets, because a lot of people in social media can say everything they want to say about you without having your face-to-face confrontation. They can say it in that genre, if you will. But I had to learn myself why I believed it. And you're on that road this weekend to find out why you believe you're a conservative. And to have like-minded people that, in fact, you can call on and talk to about those things, you know, in your life. My father really knew who his audience was. Thank you. And he proved that through his life. If you go back, and you'll hear about it, 1983, he gave a speech to the Evangelical Conference. It was the Evil Empire speech. Have you heard about the Evil Empire speech? Well, who was the audience? If you really look at that day and understand that day, and I write about this in my book, that my father at the Evangelical Conference was talking about the Evil Empire, the Soviet Union. But the audience he was talking to was not the audience in front of him. They were the ones giving him applause. But the audience he was talking to was the Nathan Sharanskys of the world, half a world away, in Soviet gulags, held there by an evil empire. That was his audience. In fact, when my dad gave that speech that day, he didn't know if Nathan Sharansky had ever heard that speech. Ever. And it wasn't until he was president of the United States and he was in his office and one day and Nathan Sharansky, one of the dissidents, came to visit the White House. And he came in and saw my father in the Oval Office and he told my father that my father gave that speech. They capped it out on the floor of the gulag where he was. And one of the guards let them know what the President of the United States was saying. And they cheered in these gulags that day. My father never knew that until a few years later when he was in the Oval Office. And my dad was so excited when Nathan Sharansky told him this. He opened up the doors of the White House and called all of his staff in to introduce Nathan Sharansky to them and tell his staff he heard the speech. He heard it. Because you've got to understand, when he was giving that speech in 1983, nobody in his staff thought he should say evil empire. Everybody was against Ronald Reagan mentioning the evil empire, except for one man. And he happened to be the president of the United States, my father. And he said evil empire because it was the right thing to do. It was the right thing to say. And it had an effect that lasts to this day because of that evil empire speech. You've all heard about the speech of the Brandenburg Gate, the tear down the wall speech. Another great speech, but again, the staff was fearful of my father saying, tear down the wall. Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall. You didn't want to upset Mikhail Gorbachev. But my father, you see, wrote his speeches. In fact, growing up, I used to walk into the bedroom and back in the far right-hand corner of the bedroom was his desk. And if you went to the lower right-hand drawer and you opened it up, there were 3x5 cards in there, all wrapped in rubber bands. And depending on what speech they wanted him to give, he'd reach in that drawer and pull out all those cards wrapped in a rubber band, think, oh, this is a good speech to give tonight. See, he wrote his own speeches, and when you write your own speeches, you know what people are taking out and putting in. So they could take out, Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall, but when you're so involved in writing the speech, you know when it disappeared and you could put it right back in, which my father did in 1987 on June 12th. But again, who was the audience? And what I want you to learn from this is the fact that when you go out and speak and you're talking to people, understand there's a larger audience than just that one person you're talking to. A larger audience. And my dad knew that. And when you think about the tear down the wall speech, remember that the people sitting in front of my father that day, the ones giving the applause, and you've seen the piece of the wall here, that's the free side you're looking at, the one that's got all the color. It's the other side that wasn't free. So the people applauding that day were all free. The audience my father was speaking to were those that were on the other side of the Brandenburg Gate, those who, in fact, were not free. He wanted them to hear an American president who was going to work to bring down that wall, whether it was telling Gorbachev to tear it down or physically tearing it down himself. He wanted to make sure that wall came down. And that wasn't some new political program for my father. He had been talking about that wall since 1960s. In debates with Bobby Kennedy, he was talking about that wall. He didn't like oppression. He didn't like people being oppressed and put it behind walls and told that's where they're going to live for the rest of their lives. So that was his audience that day. And in all the speeches you look at that you'll hear about my father, think about who the audience is that he's really speaking to. Whether it's the speech that he gave, gosh, A Time for Choosing, there was an audience in front of him that day. But who is the audience? It's a much bigger audience all over the globe. When he lost in 1976, there was an audience in front of him. But the audience he was speaking to was much bigger than that, that ultimately launched the presidential campaign of 1980. So always think about who the audience is. Who are you trying to affect with what you're saying and what you are doing? Because there's people watching. And my father knew there were people watching him all the time too. He wasn't somebody who talked a great game about being a conservative. He was somebody who lived it every day of his life. No matter how you caught my dad, at whatever level, that's the way he was. The father that you'll hear about is the same father that raised me. Sense of humor that you'll hear about and read about, same sense of humor that, in fact, I heard from him all the time. He was able to laugh at himself. He didn't get very angry. I only saw him get angry a couple of times. Once when they shut off a microphone on him in 1980. Another time where he threw his glasses across the table because part of his staff just wasn't listening to what he had to say. But he didn't lose his temper. He knew what he wanted to accomplish, and he knew he had to work with people to accomplish it. How many of you have been upstairs and seen the desk that the largest tax break in American history was signed on, August 13th, 1981? How many have seen it? You're going to see a replica of it. Hopefully it's a replica out there because it gets a little windy. You'll see that also at the ranch tomorrow or Saturday when you go up to the ranch. Now understand, when that was signed, it was a Democrat-controlled House of Representatives. It wasn't Republican, it was Democrat. So how does Ronald Reagan get a Democrat Congress to pass the largest tax break in American history? Well, he invited Tip O'Neill up for dinner. Tip O'Neill went to the White House for dinner with his wife. A few days later, he would tell his staff he's going to carry the legislation. His staff said, "Have you lost your mind? You disagree with this man on everything known to mankind." And they did. But Tip O'Neill was going to carry the legislation. And when they asked Tip O'Neill, "What did the president promise you last night? What did he promise to give you to get you to carry the legislation?" He said, "Well, he never talked about taxes all night long." What did he talk about? He talked about the greatness of America, the goodness of her people, and how the two of us working together can make it better for all Americans. He said, "Before I knew it, I'm having a glass of wine with the president. We're telling Irish stories, and today I'm telling you I'm going to carry the legislation." Now, there's an add-on to that. The other thing he told, of course, Tip O'Neill was, "Any one of the Democrats in Congress who vote with me to lower taxes, I promise not to campaign against them in the next election cycle." That also helped. But the reality was, he brought Tip O'Neill up for dinner. He sat down with him. And he was able to accomplish so very, very much by doing that. There's a sign you'll see, and maybe you've seen it, that says on my father's desk, it says, "No telling what a man can do, what he can accomplish. If he doesn't worry, who gets the credit?" I think in the world that we live in today, in Washington or Sacramento or wherever, we have too many politicians who are so busy looking how they can pat themselves on the back that they ultimately get nothing done. because they're not willing to share. They're not willing to work together towards a common end, a common goal. And my father didn't care who got the credit because he looked at the large, large picture of what he truly wanted to do. And we talk about the Berlin Wall and what have you. But how do those things happen? They happen because, again, my father in relationships. March 30th, 1981, my father is shot. He is close to death. He's on the operating table in Washington, D.C. till 4 a.m. in the morning. He's cracking jokes with the surgeons. I hope you're all Republicans. Nancy, I forgot the duck. Trying to put everybody at ease around him. 6 hours later, I would walk into his hospital room with my family to see how he was doing. And my father looks at me and he says, good morning, Michael. I said, good morning, Dad. He said, well, if you're ever going to get shot, don't be wearing a new suit. And I said, excuse me? Well, you know, yesterday I was shot. I said, yes, Dad, we all know you were shot yesterday. Well, I was wearing a brand new suit. You'd think they'd let me undress, but no. They put me on a gurney and they cut that suit off of me. And well, the last time I saw it, it was in shreds in the corner of my hospital room. So that's why I tell you, if you're ever going to get shot, don't be wearing a new suit. And I said, well, Dad, thank you very much. I'll tell Nancy to get the brown one out if that should ever happen to me. He said, well, that young man who shot me. I said, yes, John Hinckley. Yes, Hinckley. I understand his parents in the oil business. Yeah, they're in the oil business. Well, I understand they live in Denver. Well, yes, Dad, they live in Denver. Well, do you think they have any money? Now, I'm thinking to myself, what in the world are we doing here? Where are we going with this one? And my dad looks at me and says, well, do you think they'd ever buy me a new suit? And that's just the way he was. He never got the new suit. But that was how he looked at it. That's how he looked at it. But from that bullet to a few months later, Pope John Paul faces an assassination attempt in Rome. And both men did something that brings them together to move forward that ultimately would make Poland free and bring down the Berlin Wall. Both of them, before they went back to their respective duties, my father to the White House, Pope John Paul to the Vatican. Imagine if I asked everybody in here, how many of you could recite the Lord's Prayer? I probably would get everybody in the room could say I could recite the Lord's Prayer. But let me ask you the more important question. How many have lived the Lord's Prayer? Because those are two people who actually lived it. My father forgave John Hinckley for trying to kill him, so much so that my father tried to go see John Hinckley to tell him personally. But John Hinckley's doctors disallowed it because they didn't think John Hinckley would be up to it mentally. Pope John Paul forgives his would-be assassin and has him basically in the hospital room to forgive him for trying to kill him. Both men lived the Lord's Prayer. And a few months later, they would get together for the very first time in their lives and forge a friendship that was probably born in a bullet in the Lord's Prayer that would ultimately bring freedom to Poland and ultimately bring down the Berlin Wall. Neither one of them wanted to be patted on the back. Neither one of them wanted to take the credit. They looked at the big picture and say, what can we do working together? And so they worked with the Helmut Kohls. They worked with the Lech Walesas. They worked with the Vaclav Havels. They worked with the Margaret Thatchers and others to do the same. None of them taking credit, but all of them getting credit for bringing the Cold War to an end and bringing down the Berlin Wall. That's working together. That's finding common people and finding the big picture and not worried who's going to get the credit for doing anything. Another example of that is the START II agreements. Three times my father gave the START agreement to Mikhail Gorbachev to sign. Three times Mikhail Gorbachev walked away from the table. And in 1987, shows up in Washington, D.C. with his own START agreement to give to my father to sign. My father looks at the START agreement, and his staff does, and it's the same exact START agreement that my father had given to Mikhail Gorbachev three times, and Mikhail Gorbachev had walked away. But now Mikhail Gorbachev was giving it to my father. My father could have said, excuse me, Mikhail, that's my START agreement, not yours. I'm the one that wrote it, not you. But he didn't, because he knew he had to build up Mikhail Gorbachev in his own country if he was ultimately going to be able to do what he wanted to do, which bring down that wall. He needed to uplift Mikhail Gorbachev. So he signed the START agreement. He allowed Washington Post. He allowed Newsweek magazine. He allowed the New York Times to give credit to Mikhail Gorbachev. Because the big picture was, hey, I need to bring down a wall. That's what I'm after. And I can only do it if I've got this guy in the right spot. And they forged a friendship. And you've seen the picture of the two of them up at my father's ranch, even though Mikhail Gorbachev, you know, all these politicians always try to wear something that they think they should wear at a ranch event, but nobody has the guts to tell them the hat's on backwards. But Mikhail Gorbachev came to that ranch, came up here to Rancho Del Cielo and spent a day up here. And I was lucky enough to be there when he was there that day with his family. But again, it was forging relationships, building relationships, even with people you may disagree with vehemently on so many issues. But you know, if you can find that one nugget, you can move forward and make the world a better place to, in fact, live. And my father was able to do that. And I hope you learn this weekend from that also, other than learning all the other conservative things you're going to learn from all these great speakers, but really get to know and understand Ronald Reagan. His faith carried him. When he was shot, and he ended up going back to the White House, and he writes in his diary that he felt that he was saved for a reason, and he had rededicated his life to God. My father became more spiritual. And it was wonderful to see. In fact, the last time my father and I flew in here to the ranch area, flying to Point Magoo, it was Good Friday, 1988. And as we landed, my father counted out the number 9 on his fingers. And I said to my dad, what is significant about the number 9? He said, in 9 more months, I'll no longer be the president of the United States. I said, is that important to you? He says, yes, it is. I said, why? He said, you know, ever since I looked out the window of the limousine back in March of 81 and saw people laying in pools of their own blood with bullets that were meant for me, I haven't wanted to put anybody else in harm's way like that. So I haven't been going to church on a regular basis because I don't want something terrible to happen in a church because people are after me. So I'm really looking forward to being able to go to church once again when I'm no longer the president of the United States. And when he left the White House back on January 20th, 1989, and that was his last day, he never missed church again until Alzheimer's set in. And then the minister would go up to the house, and the minister would always say, I came up to minister to the president, but the president ministered to me. And I guess you could say that about my dad. He ministered to all of us at some point in our lives. Ministered to me, knowing his Christian faith, his Christian belief. Wanting the same thing for all of his children. But that was his basis. You could take conservatism, you could take everything you learned about Ronald Reagan. What's the base? What was the base? And the base was his faith and who he was. Because without that faith, none of the rest of it would have worked. None of it would have happened. It was that base. And what you've got to find, and I know you're young, you got to find that in yourselves. You got to find out, who am I and what am I and where am I going? But what is the rock that's going to keep me grounded to move me forward? What is it that's going to have other people looking at me and saying, I want part of that? I want to be part of that person because of their attitude and the way they are. They don't get angry, but they speak such great sense in everything that they talk about. Learn to care about America the way my father cared about America. You're going to run into people all of your lives you're going to disagree with. All of your lives. You may not run into them now, but someday you'll get married. Then it's just a fact of life. But you're going to run into people you're going to disagree with. Find the nugget of agreement. What does it say on my father's gravesite? In all men, there is good. Find that good. And you can move forward from there, and not only move forward, you can move mountains by finding the good in people. And that's really your charge. Have a rock, something you can hang on to, something that's going to keep you grounded. But look for the nuggets of good. Even in the liberals, there's a nugget somewhere. Find it. And you may be able to pass the largest tax break in American history. Or you might be able to bring down a Berlin Wall. Or you might be able to get a Nathan Sharansky or someone who's held in a gulag to become free. None of those things would have happened had my father not found those nuggets in other people. And he was willing to work with them. And those people were willing to work with him because they trusted him. And that trust ended up changing the world and making the world a freer place for each and every one of us to be able to live. Have a great weekend. Thank you. I guess we're doing some Q&A. Would that be questions and answers? Who has the answers? Do I get to ask the questions in the...
If you have a question, please raise your hand. Make sure to say your name and school, and we will
come
to
you. Oh, I don't
have
a question.
All the way back there.
Hi, I'm Adriana Maljanian, and I'm homeschooled. I live in Altadena. My question would be, what do you think would be Governor Reagan's approach to the problems in the state of California right now?
Yeah. When he took it over, they say it was spending $1 million a day more than it was bringing in. But when, I think one of the problems we have in the state of California is there's no leadership. There's no leader at the head of the party. You have the Republican National Committee's given up on the state of California. Basically, we are an ATM machine to everybody who's running for office, but nobody stays overnight. They come in and take their money and go, goodbye. And you really have to rebuild the party. And I think part of it is the fact that you have some Republicans in the state who serve in our state legislature who are willing to live with what the Democrats have allowed them to have, so they can keep their little positions of power, if you will. I have a friend of mine who just had dinner the other night, Mike Antonovich, supervisor in Los Angeles for years. And Michael's running for 2nd District for the Senate. Be a great senator. I wish he was young enough to run for governor. But let's face it, we live in a state where the Republican Party couldn't even find somebody to run for governor. And so we get when you think that Jerry Brown's the most conservative person in Sacramento, you really have issues in the state. So it's about rebuilding the party. And part of it is rebuilding the party with younger people. You know, it's the GOP for a reason, the grand old party. except it's getting older. And they really have to reach out and expand the party. And I think the Republican Party was much more inclusive when my father was governor and or president than maybe it is today. So they have a lot of work to do. I was Mike last night. We looked around the room, and we just talked about these things. Said you'd never see a Republican event with the different ethnicities of people that were in that room that support Mike. They need to do that. And they need to do it not every 2 years or 4 years. They need to do it every day of every year. A lot of people talk about the Democrats, but I tell you the great thing about the Democrats, they live 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year in the Hispanic, Black communities. And so they get voted for each and every time. Why? Because they have befriended these people. Not these people have any reason to agree with them politically, because they're nowhere. But they've been in their rooms, they've been in their houses, they've been in their businesses, they've been in their communities so much, they have become friends of the family. Well, Republicans need to start becoming some friends of the family if we want to start taking the state back. Andrew, is that an okay question?
Hi, I'm Zach. I'm from Orlando, Florida. What would President Reagan think of Donald Trump?
I don't think he would think. What would he think of Donald Trump? I think that my father would be very, he would not be happy with the election and what's going on right now. My father knew that you don't get ahead by demeaning people, calling people names, people you're running against, running with, what have you. And he would be really taken aback by seeing campaigns going in that direction. And so I don't think he would be in the Trump camp at this point. I don't know what camp, he wouldn't be in Hillary's camp, but I think he would like to really sit down with a Donald Trump and speak to him man to man what he really needs to do. And what he does not need to do is think of himself as being on the front pages of the newspaper every day because he wants to take Hillary off the front pages. Sometimes Hillary needs to be on the front page, like Orlando 2 days ago. I mean, when you have the father of that killer of the nightclub down there who killed 49 people sitting in the third row behind Hillary Clinton, and Donald Trump says something that takes that off the front pages, that's just bad politics. Being a businessman might be nice, but business and politics are two different animals. And Donald Trump hasn't learned that yet. He needs to learn it. Yeah. I did say one time, you know, I did say in one tweet, because people say, well, Donald Trump, just like your father, I said, well, if Ronald Reagan were like Donald Trump, Nancy never would have married him. Just being honest here, okay?
Oh, me? Oh, yeah, cool. Okay, Naaman's cool. Hi, I'm Sebastian Morales from...
Speak slow. I'm old.
Oh, who? No. I'm Sebastian Morales.
Okay.
From Rio Mesa High School in Oxnard, California. And my question's not too much on, political, spectrum type thing, but it's more of how we have a majority of just two parties. And do you think third party should be or be allowed to have more room to grow? Because I feel with just two parties, you kind of get grouped into just a giant camp that may not necessarily grasp your entire view of things.
Well, you're never going to have a tent that's going to have the complete, everybody's going to agree inside the tent. I mean, I think that's one of the problems we have today, where my father really did have that 80-20 rule. He didn't just talk about it, he actually lived the 80-20 rule. I think there's too many people today who have the 100% zero rule. If you're not with me 100% of the time, I'm with you none of the time. And I think that's one of the problems we've had within the Republican Party in the last few years. There is room for growth probably with the Libertarian Party, but you understand that Democrats and Republicans set up the system. You never set up the system to help someone else other than yourselves like that. But I did tweet the other day that maybe the most adult people in the room during this campaign are named Johnson and Weld. but they'll never go anywhere because they're not going to get in the debates. I'd love to see them in the debates. I think they belong to be in the debates. I'd love to see that third party at least give that a shot because they're a legitimate third party, even though they have no support because they're libertarians, if you will. But they're Republican governors, so they needed a party to run on. They ran as libertarians. I'd like to see more involvement, but as long as the parties are going to push everybody to the side rails, if you will, is really not going to change. So therefore, it's incumbent upon Republicans to find out how do we enlarge the tent? How do we bring people into it? And instead of finding those areas of disagreement, find the areas of agreement and move from there, like I was talking about when I was speaking. My dad did that on a regular basis. He didn't push people away. He didn't call people names. He didn't lash out. He said, okay, what can we do to bring you on, not push you out the door? And we need to do that to bring, libertarians used to be, they're Republicans. They're all over here. They could be in the Republican Party if you would allow them.
Good to see you today. My name is Benjamin Schrader. I go to St. Dominic Savio Catholic High School. And I was wondering, what is the most important thing that you think your father taught you that you could tell us?
Forgiveness. Faith and forgiveness. I think I talk about this in the book. I think the faith, seeing his faith. But essentially, I was raised Catholic. My mother was, in fact, buried as a Dominican nun, Third Order. And I tell people when I go out and speak, I'm introduced, I get big applause because I'm Mike Reagan. I spoke at a Legatus conference a couple of years ago, which is a Catholic businessmen's group, and Cardinal Sandri was there from the Vatican. And I said to him, I said, thank you for the applause from my father. However, when you all pass and you go to heaven and you see my father, look three floors up. Because I'm thinking that a Dominican nun Third Order has still got a higher spot in heaven than a politician you may love type thing. And they all kind of chuckled and laughed with all of those things. I forgot the rest of the question because I started thinking about the Catholicism and so on. But ask me again.
What's the most important?
Oh, that way, yeah, it was faith and forgiveness. I was in the hospital last October for 29 days. You have a lot of time to think when you're in the hospital. And I had gone through some things for about three years. And they were really terrible to my health and everything else that somebody was. I was eating it all up. It was eating me inside, what I was going through. Anger, mad, just everything. And I learned a lot sitting there in that hospital. And I was actually finishing the book while I was in the hospital with all these other issues I had going on. My daughter Ashley was kind of helping me through it with my writer. And I really learned that I really needed to learn to forgive. I really needed to learn to do that if I was going to really get on with my life. And my dad forgiving John Hinckley, here's the President of the United States shot by a would-be assassin. And before he does anything else, he forgives the man who tried to kill him. And then you see, as I said, all the things that were able to move from that point on in my father's, presidency, what he was able to accomplish. Because he had that freedom of not being angry, that freedom of forgiveness. And I did. I learned that forgiveness laying on my back for 29 days and my side and my front and everything else for 29 days. Last October and first part of November, I learned about the fact I've got to learn to forgive. I've got to forgive the man who is doing nothing but causing pain and consternation in my family. And until I can forgive him, I'm not going to be really get on with the rest of my life. I think that was a great, great message my father taught me, but I didn't learn it until October of last year. So when I talk to you, I'm not saying you have to learn this tomorrow afternoon, but something to think about and nurture and find out. Like I didn't know why I was conservative until I started thinking about it in the 1980s and somebody called me on the phone, called me on it. why are you conservative? I don't know. Because my dad is? I mean, that was not a right answer. So that's what I learned last October, laying in a hospital room. In fact, I had quadruple bypass surgery and a pacemaker, all brought on from genetics. The blood vessels going to my heart were 2 millimeters, should have been 4, clogged 90%. My heart was strong, a resting heart rate of 41. Like doctor said, genetics got you. But as I was being wheeled into the operating room, the doctor said to me, he says, is there anything you'd like to say? And I said, yes. He said, what? I said, when I wake up, I want to see my family, not my parents. Doesn't that make sense? I mean, something went terribly wrong if I see my mother and my father, okay? Gosh, Doc, we need to talk. But anyway, so forgiveness.
Hi, Justin Wilkie. I go to Canyon Crest Academy in San Diego. And I'm just curious, how do you think your father would respond to radical Islamic terror as we know it today?
Well, he would probably call it radical Islamic terror as we know it today. I mean, that would be a start point. If I tell you a story, I can't tell you how he would respond today other than he would call it what it is. But I will tell you how he responded to a terrorist when he was president of the United States, which may give you a vision, and I write about this in the book, a vision of what he might do today. 1983, my wife Coley and I are having dinner with my father and Nancy, Century Plaza Hotel in Beverly Hills, Century City. We're done with dinner, we're having coffee, talking, phone rings. It's Ed Meese, who is the works for my father's, basically the go-to guy, chief of staff. And he's saying to my father, he's sending planes out from Tripoli, and they're locking on to our boys. And there's fear that one of Gaddafi's planes will fire upon one of our planes. The admiral wants to know, what is it we should do if we're fired upon? My dad did not even hesitate. My dad said, fire back. Ed said, yes, Mr. President. The admiral also would like to know, if they're fired upon and they turn and they run, what should they do then? My dad says, chase them. Next question, Mr. President, admiral would like to know, if they fire upon our boys and they turn and run back into their own airspace, what should they do then? And my dad said, Ed, you tell the admiral, if we're fired upon, you chase them all the way back to their hangars if necessary, but you will shoot them down. Yes, Mr. President, should I call and wake you should that happen? My father says, Ed, only call me if our boys are shot down. Good night, Ed. Good night, Mr. President. And my dad went to bed. And by the way, my dad did not call the United Nations to ask permission to be president. He just went to bed. And the next morning, if you Google it, you ever read the story on that, the next morning, there are 2 Russian MiGs in the ground. And the big story that morning was to Ed Meese, why didn't you call the president of the United States? And at one point, I think Sam or someone caught up with my dad that day and asked my dad, why didn't Ed call you? And my dad said, well, I told him only if our boys are shot down to call. And Our boys were shot down. There's no reason to call me. I got a good night's sleep. Good night, good night. And he went back in the White House. That's the way he handled that at that point in time. Or when he did the flyby with Muammar Gaddafi in the middle of the night with two F-14s going into Tripoli. And the fact is it kept Muammar Gaddafi basically underground for 25 years. He never moved. Dad knew what he wanted to do and how to do it, and he had the right people around him to be able to make those decisions. And he wasn't afraid of the United Nations. He wasn't afraid of being president of the United States and having somebody in New York in a tall building that the electricity doesn't even work half the time, you know, saying whether he was doing it right or doing it wrong. So that's how he handled it when he was president of the United States. And I hope that gives you some kind of view to how he might handle it today. I would simply tell you, knowing my father, that ISIS and their training camps and their home of wherever they are would probably no longer exist. Because in the middle of the night, something may just come get you. Yeah, that's how he thought. You get a lot more done in those things instead of announcing what you're going to do. Also, you just show up, and you're there. And he would have the military, by the way, to be able to handle it also. That was a great story that night, too. It was so cool. So listen to this thing. Admiral wants to know. I'm envisioning these our guys flying and Gaddafi sending these guys out and our guys, and I got my dad on the phone with me saying, just kick their butt. They shoot at you shoot back. That's what you do. Today, those aren't, my dad had different rules of engagement than we have today. Yeah.
Hi, my name's Kevin.
Where are you?
Hey.
Oh, okay, hi.
I go to Florida International University. I'm a freshman there. I was just wondering, you believe in the 80-20 rule. Is there anything Ronald Reagan agreed with the Democratic Party?
Yeah, he agreed they should shut up. No, is there anything he agreed with? I don't know if they're saying, it wasn't a matter of agreeing. It was a matter of finding a way to bring them to the table. And he would find ways to do that. Sometimes he had to negotiate and give things away in order to get things that he needed. I mean, he looked at politics like a football field. It's 100 yards long. You can go 10 yards at a time. You'll get to the other end zone. You don't have to be throwing Hail Mary passes and nobody's there to catch it. You take your ball and you go home. So, you know, you had to find ways to work with some of these people. And he caught hell from his own people sometimes, from conservatives. For changing a tax code, tweaking this and tweaking that. They weren't happy with the 1986 law that gave us the immigrants, and which we still talk about today. So there were some things he did that even made his own side upset with him. But again, in leadership, that's going to happen. You're never going to make everybody happy all of the time. You're going to do things that are going to upset somebody. At some point, whether you're going to upset Republicans, you're going to upset Democrats, but what is the long view? Where are we going with the long view here? And if you look at Ronald Reagan's long view, it was pretty good. And it worked out pretty well in the long run because he had that kind of a view. Even though there were people on both sides of the aisle that he would fight with sometimes, ultimately they would come together and get things done and accomplished.
Hi, my name's Christina. I go to Springfield High School in Pennsylvania. And my question is, what steps do you think need to be taken to make, to loving America again?
To what?
To loving America again.
We have to be taught that. I mean, it's like nobody teaches anybody the greatness of America. I was, and this is really kind of unfortunate. I was playing golf with a young man about 3 years ago now, 28 years of age, ran a restaurant where I live in Burbank. I've been invited to raise the American flag at the National Cemetery at Normandy on that Sunday. I was going to leave the next morning for Paris, go out to Normandy and do that. And this 28-year-old man had no idea why there was an American cemetery at Normandy. Didn't know why. Had no idea. And so when you sit there and say, wait a minute, you know, we can blame liberals and education, all this, because maybe it's a, you know, eighth of a page or three sentences in its history book. We have to take charge ourselves and say, okay, you're not going to get that in school. We have to sit there and take charge ourselves and tell our kids. I learned about the greatness of America. I didn't learn at school. I mean, Sister Mary Cyprian was not teaching me about the greatness of America. Sister Mary Cyprian was saying, shut up or I'm going to hit you with a ruler. I mean, that's what Sister Mary Cyprian was telling me. And Father Pallas, when I went from the Sisters of Mercy to the Jesuits, I thought God was having a good time with me. That's not where I learned about the greatness of America. I learned about the greatness of America at home, riding out to the ranch with my father and hearing him tell those kind of stories about America and the great people in America. So for us to sit back and blame, well, I mean, we can find enough stuff to blame the media. We can sit there and blame education from now till Sunday. But how you stop those things, I mean, why do you go to homeschool? Because the education system in the United States kind of is in the tank. And I was basically in homeschool on Saturdays with my father, learning about the history of America and learning about loving America. I was in Berlin 2 years before the 20th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall. Ran into a young man that was standing there, and I looked at him. I said, what do you know about the Berlin Wall? He said, well, the Americans put it up to keep the communists out of their sector. And I said, really? You know, I don't know how you understand how quickly you can lose your freedom. I mean, I take you back to, like, August 12th, 1961. If you were right now, the ages you are, high school or college, whatever it might be, and you live in East Berlin, and it's August 12th of 1961, and you come home from school that day, and you say to your mom, Mom, I'm going to go see Aunt Gladys, or you're in West Germany, I should say, I'm going to go see Aunt Gladys in East Germany, and we're going to go to a movie and have dinner. And your mom says to you, oh, honey, that's great. Say hello to my sister. Tell her I love her. Tell her I'll give her a call as soon as I can. I've been so busy. But if it gets to be too late, honey, spend the night. We'll see you tomorrow. And say, okay, Mom, good night. Love you. Love you. And you leave. And you go to Aunt Gladys's. And you have dinner. And you go to a movie. And it gets to be late. So you're going to spend the night with Aunt Gladys because you know you're going to see your mother the next morning. Well, at 1 a.m. in the morning of August 13th, 1961, barbed wire, German shepherds, military with guns showed up, and wherever you spent the night of August 12th, 1961, you were there unless you could escape or until the Berlin Wall came down back in 89. That's how long you were there. And a lot of young people, how many of you knew that story? Yeah. But you need to understand that. That's how quickly you can lose your freedom. And if you don't believe that can happen, pick up the phone tomorrow and call Crimea and ask them how they're doing. What do you think of Vladimir Putin these days? Oh, really? Yeah. Well, when my dad left office on January 20th, 1989, he gave a speech, I think, the night before. And he talked about one of the proudest things of his administration was that during his tenure of 8 years as President of the United States, communism did not take over one square inch of land anywhere in the world. It wasn't like that under Jimmy Carter. It certainly isn't like that under Barack Obama. And it certainly won't be like that under Hillary Clinton. But that was what my dad was so proud. That not only did the Berlin Wall ultimately come down because of my father and working together with others, but ultimately a lot of the world stayed free because communism did not make an insurgence into their land and take over their land as what's happened under Vladimir Putin, now heading the Soviet, former Soviet Union being reconstructed, if you will, known as Russia. So those are things you really need to understand. And if it wasn't for America working with others, that Berlin Wall would still be up. The Cold War would still be going on if those people did not find a way to work together. Israel today would not be repopulated by the refuseniks like Nathan Sharansky's and other that were in gulags if it wasn't for the United States of America. When my dad talked about the shining city on a hill, he really saw it that way, as a shining city on a hill, a beacon to the rest of the world. And that's the way we really need to see it. Do we have our problems? Do we have our setbacks? Yeah. And people say, well, it'll never be the same. We don't know that. It'll never be the same if that's the attitude we take. It'll never be the same if we go out of here with our heads down and say, we never have a chance. My guy doesn't get elected, things are going to get worse. Well, you know something? With what you're learning here, you could be the future of this country. Just to give you a little reminder, with all the other stuff going on, my generation's left you a $19 trillion debt. And you're going to have to pay it. And you're either going to pay it through leading or just accept it's going to get worse and do nothing. Ronald Reagan did something. He got engaged. He didn't let bad things that happened to him stop him from moving forward. When he didn't get the job at Montgomery Ward, he found a job in radio. When he was doing radio, he got a chance to sit there and do movies and television. When he was fired from movies and television, he ended up giving a speech called A Time for Choosing. I mean, think about that. If he doesn't get fired from General Electric Theater, he's not running for governor. But when he had the time after being fired, he had the time to write a brand new speech that he gave to the world called A Time for Choosing, and it changed not only his life, but it changed the history of the country. One man can do it, working with other people towards a righteous goal. And the goal is to love America. And no matter what people say to you, love America more than you hate someone else. We're good? I get my paycheck? Oh, I got the water. Good. Hey, again, hey, thank you very much, everybody. And have a great weekend. What you're going to find out when you see the ranch is you'll see the strength of Ronald Reagan, the humility of Ronald Reagan. If there was no yearling row I grew up on, or no Rancho del Cielo you're going to see on Saturday, if those did not exist, there would be no Ronald Reagan Presidential Library. My father garnered his strength from that ranch and from the ranches that I grew up on. Find your areas in life where you can garner your strength and use that as your kickoff to make it all better and make a better world for all of us. Thank you again.
Mr. Reagan has graciously agreed to sign books for the students and parents if you're interested in purchasing one as well. But before I release you for that, just a few announcements. Parents, thank you so much for joining us tonight, and we look forward to you being with us throughout the weekend. Your tour is tomorrow. For those of you who are signed up, If you're registered for the ranch tour, you can check in beginning at 8:30 in the morning. And if you're on the wait list, I'd encourage you to get here early. And hopefully we'll be able to accommodate you if some spots open up. Students, just a few ground rules for this evening. You are to be in your rooms by 10 o'clock. We will be walking you over together, so please do not leave without being escorted by the foundation staff. We'll be walking you over to both of your hotels. Gentlemen, you are not allowed in ladies' rooms and vice versa. I'll remind you that all of you signed a responsibility pledge, and we want you to have fun this week, but we also want you to be respectful of the rules and of other guests in the hotel, as well as your fellow students. I am staying in the Mason Beach as well, and I'm in room 101 if you need anything. I'm available 24/7, so if I'm not here with you at the center, I'm probably back at the hotel, room 101. You cannot get out of the hotel without passing my room, and I do that for a reason. But that's also so if you need anything, I'm available. And in the Avania Inn, Madeline and Claire are in room 219, and they are also available.